June 5, 1981. The CDC published a morbidity and mortality weekly report describing cases of a rare pneumonia in otherwise healthy young gay men in Los Angeles.
But it was from those reports that the great epidemic of AIDS began to mushroom, and we were in the midst of it before we knew it.
I didn't know what it was, but I'd made a decision then in the middle of the summer of 1981 that I was actually going to change the direction of my career and start bringing into the hospital and studying these unusual situations of gay men who had the strange disease.
When the pattern went from gay men to injecting drug users and then finally to persons with hemophilia, there could really only be, in a unifying hypothesis, a viral agent that could be transmitted through a variety of means.
Once we got the virus in our hands, namely in 1984 and 1985, then we began to study in earnest some of the pathogenic events.
By the time the virus was discovered, there were more than 500,000 people in the United States infected with it, and millions worldwide.
We really ended up following in the AIDS clinic about 25,000 patients with HIV. The average person we would see would have 4 or 5 opportunistic infections and then succumb.
AIDS was and is a public health problem, but one with many social and political facets.
The AIDS community's response was a mixture of insider and outsider tactics. So sitting down with policymakers, trying to work out and find the best solution. At the same time, a lot of street activism, a lot of demonstrations.
The activists were making extremely good points about the uniqueness of this, the need to do more, the need to be less rigid in our regulatory approaches towards the approval and testing of new drugs, and the rigidity and lack of flexibility in how we design clinical trials.
1985 was the year that a boy with hemophilia named Ryan White was barred from attending school because he was infected with HIV. That same year, actor Rock Hudson died of AIDS, bringing attention to the disease in a way no one had before. In 1987, the AIDS Memorial Quilt was displayed for the first time on the National Mall. The following year, Dr. Koop's message, Understanding AIDS, was mailed to every household in America. In 1990, Ryan White died at the age of 18, and Congress passed the Ryan White Care Act, providing access to treatment for uninsured people with HIV/AIDS.
Because of the HIV virus that I have attained, I will have to retire.
The following year, basketball star Magic Johnson held a press conference that changed the way many people thought about HIV/AIDS. The early 90s were marked with progress despite some setbacks. In 1994, an NIH trial found AZT was shown to prevent transmission from mother to infant during childbirth. The first protease inhibitor was approved in 1995, a huge advance in managing HIV infection. However, AIDS remained the leading cause of death for African Americans.
We were 25% of folks impacted by HIV in 1986. And yet, you know, the response in black communities and the delivery of services at that time, primarily prevention and awareness services, to black communities were disproportionately low.
By 2002, about half the people living with HIV worldwide were women.
For women to recognize the risk, especially for heterosexual African American women and Latinas in the U.S., I think risk awareness is still a very, 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 very big challenge.
As the epidemic entered its third decade, the focus turned global. In 2003, President Bush announced the President's Emergency Program for AIDS Relief, or PEPFAR, providing billions of dollars to fight and treat HIV/AIDS in countries around the world.
PEPFAR has been really the most remarkable program. We are now at 3.2 million people on antiretroviral treatment, all of whom would have died. I think it's a remarkable contribution that the American people should feel very proud of.
Now it's part of President Obama's broader global health issue, so it's even taken bigger impact now because it's being linked to other global health problems.
And today we're releasing our national HIV/AIDS strategy.
Announced in 2010, President Obama's national HIV/AIDS strategy was aimed at preventing infections, expanding access to care, and reducing disparities.
I think that we are in a period of time where we have the tools to end the AIDS epidemic in America today and across the globe. And that's critically important, and it's exciting.